Welcome to Fraserview Church online service.
We're glad you're here with us.
We are continuing on in the messages around 1 Corinthians. So join along and see what you learn.
And there's worship music, and sing along.
We are looking at Paul's summary of the gospel, the good news, in 1 Corinthians 15. In the first two verses, Paul reminds them of the gospel they received, that they stand in, and by which they are being saved. The three tenses of salvation which complicate our interaction with the gospel. It's something that we have received in the past. It's something that we stand in the present, that we build our lives off, and it is something that we expect to be completed in the future. Paul's summary of the gospel begins with that Christ died for our sins. Jesus came as a human to be with us, to be like us in our fullness of our humanity, and to do something for us that we could not do for ourselves. That's escape from sin. Then Paul says that he was buried, reminding us that even Jesus had to wait for God to act. And we come to the third of those phrases today, that he was raised on the third day.
Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain.
For what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also, as to one abnormally born.
For I am the least of the apostles, and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me. Whether then it was I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believed.
That he was raised, the claim about Jesus that has caused confusion throughout history. And humans have always been trying to answer that question of what happens to us after death. And they've created a whole range of methods to do that. And I think four of the most common that we come across throughout history is sort of the idea that you continue on in your ancestors, or you are reincarnated, or you go to some place which is both the same and different from here. It's always a better place. And more recently in history, people have come to the idea that after you die, you just cease to exist. In Jesus' day, the Jews expected there to be a resurrection. But they expected the resurrection to happen at the end of time when God returned to restore his people. And when he returned to them, those who had been faithful, who had lived by his commands, who had witnessed to him in the world, who had demonstrated his love for creation and all that goes on. And that at that point, at the end of history, God would return and that he would vindicate his people. He would say and announce to the rest of history that they had been faithful. And he would do this by resurrecting them. So the surprise that happens in Jesus is that this happens in the middle of history. That history hasn't ended. God hasn't fully returned and restored all things. Instead, the future has entered into the present through the resurrection of Jesus. The future kingdom has come in its life and its power to be part of the present age through the resurrection of Jesus. And so what occurs is that God declares that Jesus was not cursed because of his death on a tree, nor was his life insignificant just because not a lot of people got to see him, but instead that he was the model of faithfulness, that he was the one who maintained allegiance and loyalty to God in all situations, and that because of that he was vindicated in the resurrection. So where in your life have you faithfully followed Jesus in a way that other people don't understand, and that you can hope for vindication in the future by God? There are many ways in which Christians stand out from the culture they live in. As they follow Jesus, as they are his disciples, they have a different set of norms from some of the cultural norms that go on. And I think this is most clear in the areas of our understanding about sex and about marriage, both their purpose and how we should act in relation to them, and in our society in relation to how we should use money and power. And obviously these ideas all came together for me in my experience at university. A university is a place where the world is opening up and all kinds of things are going on. And as I made friends with my classmates, I realized that there were aspects about my life that they didn't really understand what was going on. They didn't understand why I wasn't a little more career focused, why I wasn't trying to get the job with the most prestige or the most money, and that didn't seem to be a focus of my life. And they didn't understand why the many people that I stopped to talk to around campus, the friends that I'd made to the Christian Union at Trinity, why I didn't ever have a relationship with any of them, why I wasn't pursuing the sort of intimacy that they often went seeking through their experience at college. And so while in one sense these were very minor things, and my friends were very kind, they were just a little confused about me, they didn't understand me, there's a sense and a hope in the future that they will at some stage come to understand how Jesus had changed my life, and that they might enter into that. And I have that confidence that in the future God will vindicate those things as being good choices as I went through college.
So I think coming to know Jesus later in my life and coming to a deep faith in who he is has been a difficult journey for my family and my friends. I think a lot of them had to do a double take or maybe even thought I was a little crazy and I lost my mind. And actually I did. I think I lost my mind and my heart to Jesus, but I do believe that's rightly ordered love and a rightly ordered place to lose my mind. I think of the first winter season, the first ski season, that I started coming to Fraserview here, and I was really determined to be part of a community. And in my faithfulness, I believed that that meant I needed to come to church every Sunday, and I needed to be part of the worship and part of the gathering around food and the gathering of chatter in the foyer. And I was really committed to that and really believed that's what I needed to do to show my faithfulness. But doing that meant that I would leave the mountain early and my family would continue to enjoy the weekend together prior to Fraserview and church and Jesus being part of my life. Our sacred space was the top of the mountain where we gathered as a family and collected and shared our joy together. And I was seriously disrupting that pattern in our family. There was a lot of disappointment, a lot of concern, a lot of questioning. What is Mom, what is Lou doing? Why is this happening? And it was a difficult time. But I'm really thankful that I persevered in that faithfulness and that I became a reflection of who Jesus was in my desire to continue to make it to church every Sunday. And through prayer and time and just lots of care and love from my family, there's now this level of understanding that that is what is important. And when I look back, I think that journey was really hard of coming to be faithful in church attendance, but I also know that it was the right thing to do. And I believe that I am a witness to Jesus in being part of a community like this.
An area that I think that I've been able to be faithful to Jesus is in volunteering and serving in the local church. I grew up in an environment that really encouraged me to serve, and I spent a lot of hours on worship teams and in different ministries, volunteering my time to the local church. And while I didn't gain a whole lot from this, either financially or even in terms of school credit a lot of the time, a lot of the people around me would question why I spent so much time at the church. But I trust that as I serve and as I spend my time with these people who invested in me and who grew alongside me, I trust that God was working through that, and I trust that he will continue to work through that.
That he was raised was the vindication that Jesus was the faithful one. The surprise was that this resurrection had happened in the middle of history. God had always been promising that he would send an anointed one, a Messiah, a Christ, someone who would usher God's people into the future kingdom that he was building. He would be one who would faithfully lead God's people into the new age, the future kingdom, where God's life would abound and life would flourish. And so what's been announced in the resurrection is that Jesus is that person, that now, in the present, God's future life, His full presence is broken in through the power of the Spirit in this one person. It is now present here with Jesus. And Jesus is then shedding and sharing that presence with his disciples. Jesus is the first fruits of the resurrection which God intends to restore all creation through. He is the first sign that comes. The story obviously gets a little more complicated, because after 40 days of being resurrected, Jesus ascends into heaven so that he can sit on his kingly throne. And what descends after Jesus ascends is his Spirit, or the Spirit. And this is the life of the future kingdom that comes and enters in to the disciples, those who are following Jesus. Those who are his people become empowered and strengthened with the very Spirit that has risen Jesus from the dead. And this allows them to overcome death, allows them to overcome evil and sin, and they can do away with all those things that have been damaging the world. And instead, that Spirit, bringing that life of Jesus, embeds into them love. It gives them joy. It gives them peace. It gives them patience. It gives them kindness. It gives them goodness. It gives them faithfulness. It gives them gentleness. And it gives them self-control and many other qualities. And so what's slowly happening is that the future life that God has planned for the holy creation is entering into the very midst of the present through the Spirit entering into the lives of the disciples and giving them the power and the qualities that Jesus had. And so my question for you is, how is Christ Jesus' future kingdom at work in your life through the Spirit? For me, I often think about this in relation to all the suffering and evil and pain that I see going on in the world. The world is a nasty and difficult place. You know, people make bad choices and cause bad things to happen in our lives. And frequently, bad choices by other people cause pain and suffering in other people's lives in ways that seem very unfair. And I think if I was left only with my human eyes, I would wonder whether there was enough good in the world for it even to keep going. But what Jesus' Spirit does for me is it convinces me that it is Jesus that can draw us all towards the future kingdom where the world is better. It is him who can heal the hurts and the sufferings. It's him who can draw the good things out of people. And as I pay attention to God's Spirit at work in the world, I see that at work in people's lives. I see people who have made miraculously good choices and have improved their life because they have been paying attention to Jesus. And I see the way in which Jesus continues to intersect with people on a daily basis as I pastor, how he has entered into them and has helped them reject the death and evil and sin that they might run to, and instead has drawn them into his future kingdom. And so the future kingdom of Jesus at work in my life gives me great hope, hope for all people, but hope for myself.
Kindness. I've never actually been so attuned to that word as when I think about Jesus's future kingdom and how that works in my life and how I can bring myself into that thinking of his kingdom. I've always thought of myself as a kind person, and in reality, it's really easy to be kind to people who are kind to me. That's the easy part. But I'm now beginning to understand what Jesus really means when he asks me to be kind to everyone. That might even include my enemies, people who oppose me, people who disagree with me. And what I believe the Holy Spirit is prompting me to do is to reorient my heart, to understand what it means to be kind to someone in the face of that oppression, in the face of conflict, and in the face of disagreement. That doesn't necessarily mean that I become somebody's doormat, but instead I focus on how I can emulate more the character of Jesus and his kindness to even people who resisted him and struggled with him. I'm not alone in this. So I'm really working in understanding the future kingdom of Jesus and how I am part of that. I'm really working to figure out how to be kind to even those people who resist me, who oppose me. I believe that's the character of Jesus, and that's the testimony I can give to his glorious life.
I think that Jesus' future kingdom is at work in my life in the area of peace. While it's something that I'm still often working on, I find that the peace of God that transcends understanding as a part of the kingdom that I have been experiencing at times, especially in this kind of time of uncertainty. I've recently been fascinated by this idea of being amazed again by God and by the work that Jesus has done. This idea of recognizing that rather than waiting on miracles to happen, that all of life is a miracle. Rather than waiting for God to work, realizing that he is already working and recognizing the places in my life where he is already working. There's a great deal of peace that comes to me when I recognize the presence of God in my life and the fact that the presence of God is not dependent on anything that I'm doing at the time. And recognizing this is helping me to understand more the peace that comes from recognizing the work of God's future kingdom in my life.
That he was raised was the final surprise about Jesus. The first surprise had been that he had become human, that God had become human just like us. And so what has now occurred is that there is a human that has been resurrected. And that means that he has become our king. He has been anointed by God in order that he can guide us and direct us towards the future kingdom that he is bringing about. The king is there to bring about human ruling, which will cause life to flourish. And that has always been God's intention for his creation, that humans would flourish and that life would grow in the created space that he has made for them. He has given them space to increase the amount of life that is going on in creation when they act as conduits for his life to enter into creation. When I look at the world, I see much suffering and much pain. And much of this is caused by people trying to go their own way in their life, trying to make their own decisions, trying to find their own security and their own power and strength, or in giving that security to the wrong people. And so the promise of Jesus is that he is a good king. He is a loving king. He is one who is ruling over and protecting and providing for people if people will only come and follow him or only obey his instructions. His desire is that he fills the world with humans that are like him, who express the life that God has been putting into creation. And he desires to come and to heal people's wounds and heal their pains so that they may know the fullness of God's love and his truth and power in their life. And so the promise of Jesus as king is that he is ruling over the world. He is helping bring about those things when we will depend on him and draw on his spirit, when we will allow his strength enter into our life. And that provides hope for all of us who take wrong steps, who do wrong things, who suffer at the hands of others. Jesus is eventually going to enter in, and his kingly rule will bring life out of those situations. He will protect and provide for us. And we all need that. And so the question that I want you to consider is, who in your life needs to know that Jesus is king, that he is for them, that he loves them, that he provides and protects them? The resurrection reminds us of the future hope of salvation, that this is not all that there is, that there is something greater coming and that Jesus is bringing that into the world, that the joy and the laughter, the love, the peace, the truth, the beauty that we have now is only a foretaste of a much greater feast in the future when Jesus restores all of creation and recreates it all, when heaven and earth meet together through the Spirit being in us fully and in all of creation fully. And so we are invited to press forward with Jesus into that, to remember that as we follow Jesus and as we face difficulty, that the resurrection is coming, when our weakness and frailty will be swept away, and when we will see the great joy of following Jesus as he restores all of creation, so that life may flourish there.
Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of loved the Lord's Prayer for Children. Hello, Daddy. We want to know you and be close to you. Please show us how. Make everything in the world right again and in our hearts too. Do what is best, just like you do in heaven, and please do it down here too.
Why are you doing that?
So that everybody else at home can see it too. Please give us everything we need today. Forgive us for doing wrong, for hurting you. Forgive us just as we forgive other people when they hurt us. Rescue us. We need you. We don't want to keep running away and hiding from you. Keep us safe from our enemies. You're a strong God. You can do whatever you want. You are in charge now and forever and for always. We think you're great. Amen. Yes, we do.
Thank you for joining us today. I hope you stay well and be safe and wear a mask to go shopping.
If there's anything you need, give us a call and we will see how we can help you out. Also, if you have an opportunity to join us for gardening on Wednesday, it would be great to see you here. Apart from that, have a great week and we'll see you next week.
Goodbye.